गुड आफ्टरनून सर।
गुड आफ्टरनून मैम।
शैल वी स्टार्ट सर?
या वी कैन स्टार्ट मैम।
ओके कुलकर्णी मैम।
या आई एम स्टार्टिंग। गुड आफ्टरनून टू वन एंड ऑल। आई एम मिसेस वैशाली कुलकर्णी ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ जेएसपीएम्स राजश्री शाह कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स एंड टेलीकम्युनिकेशन वुड लाइक टू टेक दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू एक्सटेंड माय वार्म वेलकम to today's speaker, Colonel Anand Kumar sir, for the session 3 of day 11, AICT-sponsored two-week online faculty development program on AI and its application in biomedical engineering. It's a great pleasure to have with us today a distinct personality, Lieutenant Colonel P.J. Anand Kumar sir. I take this privilege to introduce Anand Kumar sir. Presently, sir is the founder and CEO of Critical AI Private Limited, and he is working as the CTO of DataWell Analytics Private Limited, and also heading two AI and cyber research centers in Dayanand Sagar Institute of Technology and Management, Bengaluru. Sir has pursued his M.Tech from IIT Kanpur, where he worked with the AI lab and successfully completed industrial projects as a part of collaborative automotive R&D. Sir has completed his PDG in intellectual property rights law from NLSIU Bengaluru and PGD in international business from Symbiosis. With the certification in ethical hacker from EC Council, and has completed his cyber law from Asian School of Cyber Law and Cyber Forensics from Gujarat Forensic Science University, Ahmedabad. Sir is a certified GIS and remote sensing from IIRS, ISRO, deep learning from NVIDIA, network security specialist, real-time cyber security for critical infrastructure and enterprise and infrastructure security. Sir is currently pursuing his PhD in cognitive analytics in geospatial technology for autonomous cars in GNSS denied environment from Symbiosis International University, Pune. Sir is an alumnus of National Defense Academy and was commissioned into the Corps of Engineers in 1994 and has served as the station engineer and sappers team leader in an Indian scientific expedition to Antarctica from 2003 to 2005. He was specially selected by the Indian Army to set up an AI and robotics lab at MSCTE in 2011 and had introduced AI as an elective subject to BTech and MTech students in MCTE and CME. Sir was a part of the team which was developing the battlefield management system at DGIS Army headquarters and worked on other classified projects. We are very privileged and honored to have sir here and to have the session of this. So we welcome you, sir. And may I now request sir to start with your session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. So ladies and gentlemen, basically we are living in a very disruptive world where the technologies are really trumping us. And it really doesn't matter what qualifications you have because every day there's a new technology coming up. And so the only qualification which requires is you have to have a adaptive mind which can change and which can understand and which can progress with this escalation of technology. And in a way, it's quite difficult for human beings to follow it because right now the machines, the way they are churning out data and the way they are computing, we cannot simply match that. So in a way, AI is replacing us. And it's pushing the man out of the loop in many of our professions. So today we are going to discuss about explainable AI and how it relates to biotechnology, bioengineering. So let me just share my screen. So I hope you can all see the screen here.
Yes,
and
sir.
You can hear me well. So yeah. We're going to talk about explainable artificial intelligence in biomedical engineering. And so to do that, first we need to have a very good understanding of what AI is, because right now the definitions are changing every day. And and people have very different opinions about AI, and I intend actually putting that to rest by bringing in some common understanding and perspective about AI. So when you talk about AI, people say, talk about machine learning, and they say, are you working in machine learning? Are you working in AI? So they sort of distinguish that. Is it reasoning? Is it data analytics? Is it some kind of high-end technology alone? Is it neural networks? So what is AI? To understand this, let's just drop the A part of it, which is artificial. We just look at the intelligence part of it. What is intelligence? Even that word is kind of obscure. And so essentially, what a living thing requires is to optimize its utility. So it has some utility functions. Maybe it is survival is something which is very common in all the living things. And we have problems to survive. So there are problems and we need to solve them. We have to find solutions. So intelligence is a mechanism of really finding out that solution using a limited amount of resources and limited amount of time. So if you just have a look at that picture where you have this, all the ladders put. So if you really don't know how to use it, even if you use IN technology, even if you use neural networks or deep learning or whatever, if you don't do it well, and if it's not solving the problems, then it is really not part of AI, you can say. So what is intelligence? So that is something which we need to explore. Mostly we actually relate intelligence with knowledge, which is not, true, because intelligence as such has got something to do with ignorance rather than knowledge. So intelligence is what you use when you don't know what to do. So this is John Piaget. He's the father of cognitive science, and everything you are learning, all your schooling systems are all based on his initiative and his philosophy. So intelligence is a thing when everything else fails. So if you have knowledge and you have a book and you can read it out and you can solve it, that's anybody can do. But when you don't have a solution, what is the mechanism that you use to find those solutions is what intelligence is all about. So if you look at your environment, you have your known knowns, your unknown unknowns, unknown knowns, and unknown unknowns. So this is how you can sort of split your environment into four quadrants. So known knowns are those with knowledge. So you understand that and you can manage that. So that is something we understand very well. Known unknown is you have questions, you have the right questions, but you don't have the answers. So if you're talking about what is dark matter? So it's a question, but we don't have the right answer. So there you will have research going on. So this is something what you do in research R&D. And then you have unknown knowns. So you may know something and you may do something, but you've not noticed it and you don't know how you exactly do it. So we were able to recognize human face. So you can recognize your mother's face, but you really don't know how you are doing it. So, and that question, when it doesn't pop up and you are actually solving it, but you don't know what is going on, comes under that quadrant. But a large part of your life or what exists out there is unknown unknowns. So for example, we never knew there was X-ray and we never knew there are different parts of the electromagnetic spectrum. We only knew about the visible range and we were just using it and that was our world. But slowly and slowly we started discovering that. So this conversion of unknown unknown to known knowns is something what is the mechanism, what we call it as intelligence. So it uses two different methods. One is rationalism. Rationalism is using generalized, facts and premises, mix it up together and create a new theorem. So theorem proving and all those mathematics, what you do is all about rationalism. And it actually follows modern logic. On the other side, you have empirism, where you take in evidence and you are creating facts out of different data points and you are churning them and you are creating some facts. So for example, you can start throwing things out of a tar and you know, different things, and then you will find everything falling to the ground. So you know that there is gravity, and then there is a fact which comes up that anything you throw out there is going to fall down, it's gravity. So these two processes happen like a cycle. So you have the inductive process from specific instance to generalization, which is nothing but using data and trying to create a general model of your world. The other side is deductive, which is a top-down approach. From the model of the world, you try to mix it up, and then you can create new instances. So for example, if you were to, the engineers who actually built Alborz, right? So there was no experience, there was no data of such a huge, such a tall building. But then they used the generalized method and use mathematics, and you can use calculations and science. And then you can sort of conclude that, yes, you can go till that this extent, and then you can, you need to build it in this manner. So there is no experience of that, but you can still build it. So this is something very powerful that because learning through experience is something which is very, very slow, and one person cannot learn everything. Learning from others' experience is more important. So evolution in the natural sense was learning through its own experiences, and so that was a very inefficient method. But right now we have the internet, we have information with everybody, and everybody sharing information on the internet, and we are learning from everybody's experience. So you have larger than life experience in your, individual self. So when you talk about artificial intelligence, the inductive part, you'll find machine learning, which is a general term where you use data, churn it, and create models. And there are certain functions under the machine learning bag where you have regression, classification, and clustering. So these are three different methods. We'll just go over them, one of the examples. And then if you talk about, you can do regression, you can do classification, clustering, just by doing mathematics or just by manually. But if you want machines to do it, and if you have multidimensional data, then you cannot use mathematics, you'll have to use neural networks. So neural networks also uses mathematics in the end. In the end, there is always an algorithm, but then there is a unique method of actually finding out how things are related rather than using mathematical formulas and calculus. You can learn this and create a generalized fact from specific instances, looking at all the data points, which is out there in the world, which, by the way, is escalating in the world. No human being can actually sift through all the data and create a generalized fact. And that's the same thing for biomedical engineering and healthcare and so on and so forth, because the data point is too huge, and the data sets are also too huge, because you need to look at the entire population. The more bigger the sample, the better is your prediction and creation of these facts. So that's something which is happening on the inductive side. If you look at the deductive side, you have the knowledge-based systems where you have expert systems, you have Bayesian networks and genetic algorithms. So basically it is all about taking the facts and how can you mix it up using Bayesian network, or can you use logic to use two different premises, mix it up, and conclude the third premise, what's going to happen if so-and-so is the consequence of... So this is a cyclic thing. What happens is when you use data and create models, sometimes the model is not really good. And because the data is not good, and when you actually push it through the deductive side, you will find anomalies there. So you'll find anomalies in the facts, and then you can sort of say that you need more data, you need some different kind of unknown. When you find anomalies in the known knowns, then you go and hunt for that, and you try to find out what's happening. So for example, X-ray on a sheet. So people don't know what it was, and then they started collecting different data. They knew there was something there, They started searching, they started creating sensors, and finally they found it. And now they know there is X-ray. And so intelligence, in a sense, it's a principle, just like the principle of flight, where you have birds. So we understood the principle, we took that and we created aircrafts. Now we have aircrafts which can even carry tanks. There's nothing like that in nature. And we have aircrafts which are even moving out and flying. Basically, we are using all the aerodynamics, what we learned, the principles, and then we can create it. And similarly, if you understand intelligence, if you use the principle of induction and deduction, you can create whatever is happening in the brain. The same thing can happen in a robot or also on the entire internet as such. So the main symptom or the main effect or utility is to reduce the time and space complexity. That means reducing the time to solve a problem and using less resources to solve the mobile app in your mobile phone. You will term him or her as intelligent. But if an adult is doing the same thing, it is not. So intelligence is not an absolute term, it's a relative term and depends on the ability of that machine or person or animal or whatever. So whether it's biological or it's mechanical, the effect is about solving problems in the least amount of time and least amount of resources. So if you look at how human intelligence, artificial intelligence, all this plays a role. So you have intelligence and you have something which is stupid. So any process, either it can take more time or it can take lesser time. So if you're using something which is taking lesser time and less resources, that is intelligent. So there are two things in the Venn diagram. You have the intelligence and stupidity, but then you you have the human intelligence, which has been growing from, let's say, from a unicellular organism. We have reached such an extent. And right now we are partly intelligent and partly stupid. And if you look at machines are supervised by human beings. So we are building it, we understand what is intelligence. So most of what it's doing is intelligence, and there is also some part of it which is stupid. I mean, it doesn't work so well. So we are getting there. In the past, 20 years, a lot has been done in artificial intelligence, and artificial intelligence is growing. And it's able to actually get into the intelligence space and operate much more than what human beings can do or can even imagine. And so that's how it is placed. Now, if you look at human intelligence, so this is something which we need to understand what are our constraints and limitations. So we have something known as the OODA loop: observe, orient, decide, and then act. And so to observe, we have sensors. So we have the eye. Let's just take the eye and the vision, for example. If you have a look at this, the vision, the eye is here, and then the occipital lobe is right behind. So that's again a design flaw. It happened because of evolution, because all the other parts of the brain grew in between, and there's latency out right there. But then if you look at the sensors, it's only looking at a very small region of the electromagnetic spectrum. And also, if you look at the occipital lobe, it has been, it has developed itself to actually identify and work in such a manner, in a very specific and narrow manner, where it can identify human faces very well because we are humans, but you and me cannot identify penguins. Only penguins can identify each other. For us, it all looks similar. So basically we can do certain things with our vision, which is very, very specific to our environment. But when this environment keeps changing and we are looking into other domains, doesn't really work so well. And also, if you look at the brain, it has got three different types of brain. So for any input which you receive, there are three different responses which happens. We have the reptilian brain, which is nothing but it's very automated. It's kind of robotic. It controls your heart, it controls your muscles, and so on and so forth. So, and then you have the middle brain, which has evolved in mammals, where your functions, your decisions are taken by emotions. So these are broad-based decisions, so it can't be specific. And in your brain, it starts actually, there is a kind of delay for it to actually disappear because it keeps again and again cropping up in your mind. And that's really not good because you are not taking very precise decisions. The new brain, which is more peculiar to the primates and as a human, Homo sapiens, we have the prefrontal cortex, which is pronounced and developed, which is not found in any other animals. And also in small children, they are not developed so well. So you, it only develops and matures at the age of 18 and 21, which actually is the adulthood, the same barrier threshold. So what happens is, for example, let's say we are going for a skydive and you climb up the same aircraft and you somebody asks you to jump, your reptilian brain, your hands and legs will start shaking. Your hand will start holding on to stuff. And when you fall, you're supposed to spread out, but it won't be possible for a novice because his body is so used to roll, because on the ground, if you're actually falling, it's better to roll so that you don't get hurt. But in the air, you're supposed to spread out so that, you know, your parachute opens in the proper manner. If you don't do that, if you make a ball there, then the parachute is going to get stuck onto you and you fall down. So it's not going to open. So basically, you are going against your reptilian brain. So you need a lot of training to do that. That's the ground training, what you have. Also, the middle brain, the fear factor comes up. And so you're going to be so afraid, even if you keep saying, even if you're very brave and you're cognitively from the prefrontal cortex, you're saying, okay, I have to be brave. It's not possible. So what happens is you need some kind of a training before you really go up there, and you have to gradually fight your fears and phobias. So what is training all about is about you're basically training a reptilian brain and the emotional brain. So you want the prefrontal cortex to preside over them. So they have to take control. Otherwise, you're going to have amygdala hijack. So basically, that's emotional hijack. And then you're not going to perform so well. Process, it makes you prejudiced. You have biases. And it plays out in stock market. It plays out in, you know, in life partners, how you choose your marriage and how do you invest money, and in, even in your biological decisions, I mean, even in cognitive out, and we have to take, you know, the help of machines. And there again, we are talking about explainable machines. So we'll see what, like the speed of the neurotransmitter is only 20 miles per second. Speed of light, so therefore human brain is size is limited, but machines, it can be as big as a planet, and it also deteriorates with age, with your you know, diet and your health. So all this actually causes issues, and therefore you see things like this. So we all see a face. It's very difficult to not to see that. But we also know that there is no face there. So your prefrontal cortex is telling you it's just trees. You can see that. But your occipital lobe, which is so hardwired, is seeing a face there. And this is how neural networks work. And this is a problem when we actually use the same faculty to consume, you know, all sorts of other data which we are not exposed to. We were not exposed to during our evolution. And if you use the same set of you know, algorithms in the occipital lobe and see things, we will see it very different. So it's not just limited to vision, it is also limited, I mean, it is across the board in all kinds of computation, auditory or sensory, and all sorts of information with the brain processes. Another example is just an image, but you can see it move. And that's surprising because it's just your occipital lobe telling you that there's something moving. So basically every animal has a umwelt. So they actually, you have a limited amount of reality around you, and that's what you can perceive. So the, as animals, they were just using whatever they had. But right now, humans have evolved a lot of sensors. So he's getting a lot of data, more than what it's not even found in nature, where all these data points were being used by nature. So now we have a lot more to deal with. So when you look at coming back to this, okay, you had the inductive process. So let's just take a look at the inductive process and see what's happening. So we have initially, whenever you get any kind of, let's say, numbers, so if somebody touches you, so you, let's say you are just a seaweed or something, and something touches you, you can feel it. It's just a point, right? And it's noise. If you really don't understand what is touching you and what's happening, it's just noise. But once you understand that, okay, this is about a particular attribute, and you can link it with a particular attribute, it becomes data. So for example, if I'm talking about sizes of houses, so 2 BHK, 4 BHK, so this 2 and 4, what does it mean? What does it represent? It means 2-bedroom and hall and kitchen. Okay, so we understand that. So it represents something. So this becomes data, and each point is data point. So if you're talking about this, it's a data point. But as soon as we relate it to another attribute, okay, another set of data, for example, cost of this of the flats. Now you have information. So basically, it informs you that a 2 BHK flat will cost you 40 lakh and a 4 BHK flat will cost you 80 lakhs. And if you were able to draw, and so this is basically how one attribute relates to the other. Now, these are just points. Now, if we can create a lot of, take a lot of points, you can also create a line. And what it actually helps you is it gives you the knowledge. The knowledge is something which you already know. You don't have to be informed. For example, I don't have to be informed about what a cost of 3 BHK flat would be. Now I can predict using this line, I can predict that it's going to be 60 lakhs, and more or less I'm going to be correct, because it's all about discovering this line. The line may not be exactly straight. It may have given a very simple example for you to understand what knowledge means, what information means. Information is those points, and knowledge is that line. And with that line, you can predict much more than what you can, what you have been told. So your experience is about information, okay? But your knowledge is how can you translate this information, your experience, into a generic line? And that is creating knowledge out of data, out of noise. And this is to find the equation of the line is the problem here, the regression problem. You can do that by using simple mathematics if your line was like this, straight. But if your line was, let's say, the relationship was non-linear, and if the relationship is also multidimensional, where you have lots of other data, then you can't really do, find out the exact fitment of that line, exact fitting line, using mathematics alone. So you have something like gradient descent, you have other methods and neural networks, that is what you use to find this exact fit. And in research, we give a lot of significance for this exact fit. So that is why we use the null hypothesis. We have to actually take the opposite of what we are trying to prove, and then you try to get evidence for that opposite information. So if it crosses about 1.15%, then you know that there is some problem with your hypothesis, and you can drop that hypothesis. It fails. So that's the null hypothesis, and that is what in the end we have to use to prove that whatever line you have found exactly fits the information space. Now this is very simple. Three attributes, it sort of looks like, but if you have hundreds of attributes, then you and me cannot imagine. Only the machines can do that. So machines are using parameters. You and me really cannot fathom what is happening around, and that is what exactly gives its predictive abilities and it's working fine. So neural network, in a way, so if you just go to input layer, which is here on the left side, the blue one, and then you have some hidden layers in between, and on the right side you have the output layer. So what you essentially do is, if you have an image, you can flatten it, take each pixel and feed it in on the left side. So you will have a number of neurons here, and then the connections here have got weights. So you need to actually decide on the weights to actually keep moving of the object which you're using 1000. For car, we are using 0100, and motorcycle you're using 0010s. So you have this labels already created. So the pedestrian, you put here 1000, and then you will feed in the pedestrian. You will try to adjust the weights and arrive at 1000. So that is the model which actually understands pedestrian. So next, tomorrow, if you put another picture of pedestrian, you will 0000, then you can see pedestrian. So it's a very simplistic thing. There's analysis. There are a lot of other issues which we're not going to. And to use more and more neurons and more layers, you need neurons, and that is what is deep learning all is all about. You can actually, and this can be easily done by, you know, avoid paying my property tax because COVID is on, and then I'll have to look into the state policy, the national policies, look at laws already existing, and your thing, are you exempted or not? And there are so many policies. So those will exist on knowledge base. You know, you can, but your state law may say you can't. So then now you'll have to resolve those. And those kind of resolution is what happens in the inference engine, and you get information. And there could be also uncertainties and ignorance where it will increase your knowledge base. You change your knowledge base. Maybe your knowledge base has got old policies which are not correct. So you need to update your knowledge base and improve your inference engine so that you get more and more accurate results. And that's what is expert system is all about. So the deductive process, if you actually look at some examples of premises. So your premises could be, if it rained, then the grass is wet. There are two sets of action, and you have a formula here, right here. And you can reason out in this manner. So it rains, and now without actually going out and checking, I can say that the lawn will be wet, right? So this is you using knowledge, and I don't have any information. No one told me the lawn is wet, but I can feel it. The cost can be very, very far off, and you can have an effect. So you will have multiple layers. You will have to mathematically compute what is going to happen because of change of policy. For example, if steel prices are going up, what will happen to your infrastructure growth? And will it
Dear participant, Sanand sir is facing some technical issues, so he'll be back in few minutes. then you can mark the attendance. I have put the link in the chat. Thank you. Just a minute, sir. I'll ask you to make co-host. Just a minute, sir. Yes, sir. You are co-host now. Please try to unmute.
Okay. Sorry for that. I mean, all issues with online thing.
No issues, sir.
Okay. Get back to where I was, and I think that has given people also some break. I believe. Where were we? Okay. So we were talking about deductive reasoning. Where we took some premises, that's a knowledge base. And if you want to reason, you can reason. With reason, you can now find out what is happening outside your house, right? Far away, wherever it is. And but there are also fallacies. You have the same set of premises, but if you do reasoning in this manner, that the grass is wet, therefore it is rain. So you can notice the previous reasoning was it rained, therefore the grass is wet. That is a very, very sure shot thing what you can say. But you can't reverse it. So the cause and effect, from effect, it's difficult to actually talk about cause, because the cause can be, if you have three causes for the same effect, then you cannot relate it directly. So for example, you are having fever, you can have fever because you are having some kind of tumor, or you are having some kind of infection, or you are having some kind of a disease or whatever. So from infection, from fever, you cannot really say that you are having some infection, right? Or you cannot really say you are having some tumor. So you will have to actually move from the cause to the effect. You can't move from the effect to the cause if there are multiple causes. For example, the grass is wet, therefore it rained. It's very difficult to really predict that, because your grass can be wet because of, let's say, sprinklers on, right? So if the sprinkler was on, so you can, it could be wet. It could also be your pet dog going out for the morning job, and then also it can be wet. It can be a wet because of number of reasons, somebody throwing water from the top flat floor or something like that. So this is a fallacy, and like this, there are plenty of fallacies out there. For that, you really need to get into the subject of logic. And so this fallacies are really prominent in human beings. We have various fallacies, and that's what the politicians and the others actually exploit in us. So if you look at there's another aspect to this, is symbolic computation. Till now we've been looking at English, Now the same language can be represented in symbol. So we found this out, and this is called a symbolic computation. So whatever we are speaking can be converted into a symbol, and this reasoning and this logic would still hold. So this is modern logic. So even if I really don't know what you're saying, but using your premises and using your method of reasoning, I can say whether you're fallacious or you're right. So in a way, you can differentiate, you know, bad arguments from good arguments, truth from reality. There is one more step which is required once you actually take out the fallacies by looking at the form. So this is known as formal logic and making valid arguments. The validity of the is actually the truth behind P and Q. So if P and Q are false, then again you will be trumped. But in a, this gives us a huge advantage of things which we don't even understand. We can actually use it for reasoning, and so we are using it for you know, decryption, hacking, and other things. Also in medical, the same, you can use the similar manner. So it is agnostic, it is used everywhere, this form. So in symbolic, this thing, this could be, say, the right way of saying the form is right, but because P and Q are false, again, it will amount to unsound argument and a fallacy. So you have a number of invalid arguments today. You can go and surf the online this thing content out there and understand what are these and how you must be using it. So if you can identify this among you, within you, and you can, you know, you will come to know that, you know, using machines and using analytics is much better. Calculations, computation is much better than using your own brain and trying to decide on things. So for example, if you have been in our case in the army, if you have been neutralizing IEDs, which is improvised explosive devices, and you have done two very successful neutralization, the third one could actually kill you. And it has happened because you get confidence in two of those, this thing, and suddenly the third one will be different and will kill you. So that's again building up your fallacies. It helps you build up fallacies. So basically what the terrorists do is they will plant a number of IEDs, and from one side it will be easy and the other side it will be totally different and difficult. So when you start clearing it, when you reach there, then suddenly you get surprised. So it happens even in medical, healthcare decisions by doctors and so on and so forth. So you have to have proper clinical trials, which is the inductive process. You've got to have proper deductive process to conclude what is happening and throughout argument. And so because the human mind is fallacious, you have marketing, sales, politicians, religious gurus, you know, the social media. So all of this plays an important role in actually pushing, exploiting this fallacies in a human brain. And so similar thing also works out in your profession. Now you can't experience everything and understand and learn. So this is a very humorous example. Again, if you're a suicide bomber, you can't learn by experience, right? Because you're going to be dead. So there are other ways to actually understand. So that is known as formal methods in computer science. And also if you look at, you know, medical, you know, how do you actually conclude? How do you do R&D in that? And how do you do clinical trials? Everything will involve inductive process and deductive process and formal methods. So you can't keep experiencing and learning from there. It's never going to be that way. So you have thought experiments, and that's where mathematics comes into play, and where you can discover E equal MC squared even before experiencing it. You can discover there is, you know, dark matter out there and black holes out there even before experiencing it. So mathematics tells you that there's something missing. And even the same thing will happen with genes. So you can look at genetics. It's all about mathematics with a few components. And you can really compute and say what's going to happen. But those P and Q will have to be discovered. So this is all about theorem. Here you don't require data. You don't have to, you can really predict something big. So right now we have the ability to create particle accelerators because Bose actually predicted boson, which we have still not found, but we know that it's out there and we'll find it. So same thing applies to law. It will also apply to medicine. So you will have, machines which are actually interacting with the patients first. And so you will have machines which are specialists in their own field and which can do the same job what doctors are doing. So Bayesian network looks like this. So you have different probabilities, you have nodes, and these nodes actually have different probabilities. And then you have a joint probability. So for example, if you have difficulty of an exam paper, and then you have intelligence of a human student, so now we can predict what kind of grades will happen. So if the paper was too difficult, you know the grades can come down. If the paper was easy, you know the grades will go up. Similarly, if the intelligence of the student was less, then the grades will come down, and if it was more, it will go up. So how do you play? Now you have a very difficult exam, and then you have very poor students. So what will happen to the grade? How can you predict? And this is something very simplistic model, but if you look at genetics, it looks like this. It's too huge the way things are connected. And this is from actual software which is dealing with genetics. Here you can see it's something like Google Map. So you can, you know, go to different sections and you can actually look at it. So you can't really even look at it in one screen. You'll have to actually explore it, and it's like a city. Very difficult for you to really explore everything. It's like a chip. So this is a real Bayesian network for genetics per se, and it's very difficult for us to actually predict because there's so many factors into this. And again, you can use fuzzy logic, because when you say it's hurting me, so what does that mean? People get hurt at different levels are there. So somebody says it's cold. So for Russian, it is minus 10 degrees is cold. For a person in Madras, it is 26 degrees is cold for him, right? So it is all this thing relative. So again, you will be using fuzzy logic, and all this AI systems will be using fuzzy logic there. So you've got to know what it really means when a patient tells you something or the user is telling you something. You'll have to relate it to that extent. Again, machines do that better. But then as a human interface, we have to understand what the machine is doing. Why is it switching on the AC, right? Because last time when somebody from Madras came into the room, the AC was switching on only at 26 degrees. But when a Russian came in, then it's always continuously on. So you will not understand, right? So same thing will happen with the medical, devices and the medical systems also. So it has to be customized for the individual. And there you will have to, as a doctor, you'll have to understand why it is behaving in a very different manner because of the context. Now, you will also have plenty of ignorance. So you have to understand how to handle your ignorance. So for example, you don't know anything about a particular stock or share of a particular company, then how do you deal with it? It will not be the same manner when you have to deal with another stock where you really understand the company and you can. So your ignorance will actually matter how you build systems. And so those also will have to be understood by a human operator. And then there are game theory where you have multi-agent systems. So you have this virus and then you have another bacteria. So what happens if I take this medicine? It may kill the virus and both the bacteria both. And the bacteria is essential for my survival. So again, I'll die some way or the other, right? So it's a game theory. And there has to be a mid path where all the players, all these factors are satisfied in some manner. And if you have to do that, you will have to use game theory again into the thing. So it is not that, if you want to trouble Pakistan, Pakistan has attacked us and we directly go and attack it. So sometimes if Pakistan has attacked us, you should go and attack China, because it's all related. So if you want to really kill the guy who's on the right side, you may have to slap the guy who's on the left side, and he may be your friend also. But depending upon how it is related, it affects. So that's how trade works. And that is how a human body also, within the human body, there are so many agents and players and so many different organs operating at different, for different utilities. They are at present in a Nash equilibrium. And when that thing gets disturbed, then you cannot actually use the same logic everywhere. You will have to actually play it through the game theory thing and see the response of what other agents will do. What will happen if you take this medicine, and what will happen to your liver because of this medicine, or what will happen to your heart because of this medicine. So you will have to understand all that and then build systems. So that's again a very complex process, and there are different things. So in all this technology, you have to find the sweet spot and really understand which technology plugs in where. And that is how the entire system will be intelligent, and you can call it AI. If you're going to use all kinds of deep learning and other models, but in the end, it is not in the sweet spot. It's costing hell a lot, and costing in terms of computation. Sometimes the answers are coming after the person dies. It really doesn't make sense. So the latencies, time and space complexity has to be minimum. So there is also something known as AI effect. It's like a rainbow where you can see it from a distance, but when you go close, it just disappears. The same thing happens with AI. If you see it from a distance, it looks very intelligent. But when you start looking at how we are doing it and what's happening, then suddenly you find it's just mathematics, it's just physics, laws of physics. So why does a person choose a particular object or item? Why does he prefer a particular item? Now, there could be, it's not coming from within. It's all algorithms which are running, and these algorithms are being created in your neural network, in your biological brain, by salespeople and marketing people. So they're just dumping in. That's why there's lots of money, more money than the product itself in sales. So if you can convert that, create a neural network in your brain, then it will start giving you that output. There is no other way. There's no magic to it. So a rainbow may look like magic, but actually it is science, and the effect disappears. So that's known as AI effect, because everything disappears into mathematical algorithms. And so it looks like this. We'll not go into that. And in your brain also, the same process is happening. So it's very difficult to attribute something to a person, because, well, he's got genetics all right, but then his brain is being driven by data. So the neural network is always driven by data. So how do you explain why a person chooses a thing? You'll have to understand that. And then you can sort of, why is a person hurting? Why does he have a stomach ache? So what's happening? Why is he suffering from this? So again, you'll have to go through that and understand what exactly is happening. And also you look at AI as agnostic, and it's everywhere, not only in medicine, it's the same. The same process is happening everywhere. And so for an AI scientist, there is no domain difference. He normally finds all domains are same. It's just data, create models, and move forward. So it's easy to now create a brain. We found it's easy to create a brain. And so we have DeepMind, we have projects like Prism, where US is collecting information from social media from every corner and then using it. So it's doing what Chinese had started doing now. US was stealing data from every country, stealing IPs and information, and that is how they were able to build a very good technology base and stuff like that besides their own R&D. But also they were able to play politics, and they were able to control the world. Now China is also coming in. So that's where US and China are actually at war. So it's easy to create a brain, but it's difficult to create your body and replace it with the robotics part. So because in our body, this is basically a nanotechnology challenge, which is still in R&D stage, and people are still working. So the dexterity is not there. In our hands, we have millions of cells, but if you have to make it out of, say, metals and stuff like that, your sensors are limited and your dexterity is limited, the control is limited. But in the past few years, we've seen excellent results, at least at the cognitive side. If a hand has to catch a flying missile, it will be able to do that. But we will not be able to even see that missile, because all these are used in industry right now. And you have cameras which are capturing late chips as it falls from huge bags. So it can just blow out that particular chip at that particular point. And if it's burned too much or it is not fried well, it goes out. So all these are not possible, but this is a challenge right now, and embodied computation. And so if you can just relate it to flight again, if you look at aircrafts, you can change the pilot. Pilots are going away. We have drones and we have autonomous systems. But so certain advantages, like the avionics goes away. You really don't have to explain it to the person, because every person needs explanation in his own understanding. So you really have to, there's a lot of training involved. Here it's directly connected to the brain of the machine. So you don't require avionics, you don't require life support systems, you don't require metal plates which are under the aircraft to protect the pilot. now you, because of this, all this, it can carry more ammunition, it can carry more fuel and endurance, everything increases. You don't require refresher training again and again. You know, you're practicing as a medical, this thing again, you're practicing again and again. If you don't practice, you lose your license. So, but that is not true for machines. Machines, once they reach a particular level, they remain there. There's no deterioration. There may be upgrades, but there is no deterioration. But in human mind, well, you, what you learn at 21, at 41, you start forgetting. I mean, for example, even engineers, if you ask the second year student to write an exam, what they learned in first year, they will deny it. They will not accept it because you have forgotten all by that time. And look at technologies coming and going. Even if you understand something, as you age, you become 60, you start losing neurons. Whatever you knew so well also becomes a challenge for you. So all that, logistics, fatigue, you know, there are scenarios like where nuclear biological space, where you can't use, you know, human beings, casualty evacuation, disability, huge amount of people dying and political climate, okay? So all the dangerous work like piloting or fighting wars, this will have issues, but when you look at robots, they can be replenished overnight. Overnight, you can create thousands of pilots. You just have to burn them, right? And so there are financial implications. That's how we have got a very good autopilot system, but when it comes to replacing aerostats and ground crew, that is a little far away job. So that, this is Marowak's paradox, where we say that the CEO of a company can be replaced, will be replaced, the decision makers, but the peon of the company cannot be replaced because this guy has to do a lot of things, right? Different things. So it's very difficult to break. When you look at robots in medicine, healthcare, you have robotic surgery, which is really precise. It's something like welding in automotive industries. It's very, very precise. So if you have an operation conducted by a robot, well, you can walk out of the hospital the same day. If a human doctor had to conduct the same operation, then you may have to stay in the hospital for a week or so. So that's how it is related. And plus, the doctor can be in US and then he's you know, operating on a patient who's in Chennai. So all these things can happen. Besides this, so the scope of you know, biomedical engineering is huge, where how technology is plugging in, how AI will plug in all of these spheres. So right now, so there, this is going to be an overload in every sense, not only in understanding and learning, also to operate, in the operate to operate and to manage healthcare systems. It's going to be it's going to take a toll. So you really have a lot of information, but you have not been able to create a knowledge. You really don't understand what is happening, so you can't predict, you can't consume it. So that's because of a bounded womb built. And if we don't plug into the AI systems, AI is now taking decisions or throwing out decisions, or it's helping you take decisions. You may misinterpret and you may create problems like what happened in Lion Air, where the system was taking the right decision, but the so if it is not integrated well, if the system is not able to explain it to the pilot, what, and there will be issues. So that is why you require explainable AI rather than just AI which is throwing out information, I mean output. Because depending upon the data, the AI also can go wrong. There could be exceptions there. Because if data gets spoofed or data is corrupted, then the models are wrong and the predictions are wrong. And there are false positives and false negatives, like in, you know, medical diagnostics, so, and also for predictions. So you have to improve the accuracy. So you have to catch anomalies. In order to catch anomalies, you'll have to use the formal method, the logic part of cause and effect, what I talked about, the symbolic computation part needs to be incorporated. You'll find there are contradictions, and then you will have to again collect more information and see what's happening. I mean, his ECG is showing that he's having a heart problem, but when I actually go and do the ultrasound, there's nothing there. So there must be some issue. And then you'll keep learning and refining, and then you say, okay, probably this part of the ECG machine needs to be, prediction needs to be improved. And then you improve it and do that. So if you don't try to get a explainer, AI system in your process, then because of data going wrong or some new data which is not being collected, then you may have wrong predictions. I'll give you a simple example of in UK, they thought that eating ice cream is related to crime. So if you eat more ice cream, you will worse. Because what was happening was they could see a correlation between crime and eating ice creams. But only later they found out that it was all because of summers. When in summers, people eat ice creams and ice cream consumption goes up. In summers, people, you leave the windows open. And sometimes when they go, they forget. And that is where the burglary, just by correlating, you cannot find this thing. You'll have to establish the cause. And that is very, very important. You'll have to establish why it is happening exactly. Otherwise, you will come up with such weird explanation and correlations that eating ice creams increases crime rate in a city. So when you look at big data, you'll have to do streaming data analytics, which is actually telling you for operational reasons, you'll have to do this. Historic trend analysis for R&D reasons of catching trends and again, trying to build it into your alert systems, into your real-time assistance. So this is a real dashboard for the US Navy, where there are so many factors, and depending upon what kind of user you are, you may be a radar specialist, you may be a tactical specialist, you may be a strategist, you may be a technologist, you may be a missile agent. So all of these people will require different inputs from the same machine, same system. And therefore, you have to have intuitive, customized dashboards so that it is actually giving you information what you require, rather than just overloading you with so much information that you don't know where to look and how to consume. So intuitive dashboards, as things happen temporarily, depending on the time and depending on the context and depending upon the user who's asking the question, the answer will come out. And so that is where what AI is right now doing it. And it's not just the answer coming out, right? So the issue is you have to have transparency. So right now, whatever current methods we're using is it lacks transparency. You don't know why the machine is telling you that you need to, turn off the air conditioner or something, for example. So you don't know why it is asking you to switch off the engine when the ship is running. Because if you should switch off the engine, it's bad for you. You'll have a failure coming up, and that is why the machine is telling you to switch off. So you really have to pick up those, understand those, and try to respond to it. So you need transparency. You need so right now there is inability of model generalization, because again you are collecting data, but if you don't really test it out with explanations, you may be collecting wrong data, you may be collecting bad data, small sample, or all such issues could be there. Absence of causal reasoning. So causal reasoning is important. That's what we were talking about. That is the form, that is the symbolic computation part. And also part of these difficulties are caused by black box nature of deep learning. So we have to overcome that, and I've already given you an intuition of what you could use to overcome that. So what is this explainable AI? So basically you have explainability, you have transparency, and you have provability. So in transparency, you come to know, you can get information of what is happening at each stage in between the computation. And you have the causal, this thing which actually tells you that explainability part. And you can actually prove this in mathematics, that this is causing this and these are the different factors. And that's why the transparency is there. And so these three have to be there in the box. We need to retract them from the black box. And if you look at a small example of understanding a cat, identifying a cat from a picture. So the present system is on top. The system which we are proposing is on bottom. So it says, okay, this is a cat because it has fur, whiskers, and claws. So similar thing for radiologists and for your medical diagnostics or understanding human condition, health condition monitoring, and things like that. the system should tell that, okay, this guy is in high alert, but it should also tell why it is saying so. What is the reasons of this? So that is explainable interface, and that's what we need to build in medical systems. So explainable AI, short form is XAI. It aims to address the problem by developing approaches for understanding the black box models and make reliable estimation predictions. So that's what it's about. And it aims to further the research direction by using all this Bayesian modeling and other methods, deductive methods. And so it analyzes the DL models, the deep learning models, using, again, formal logic. So once you get the output, you will have to check out the anomalies, so on and so forth. So that's what is explainable AI all about. So again, if you look at, there is also a temporal thing for explainable AI. So you can, from a video, pick up different instances, events, and then correlate it and say what's happening. So if you just take an image, let's say somebody holding a knife and the other guy is dying in front of him, you don't know whether this guy is killing him or this guy is taking out the knife from his stomach. Is he helping him? So you have to have the temporal this thing. Again, explainable AI considers all this, because once it comes to a conclusion, it tells you the specific instance why you think that this person is doing a terrorist, why you think that this person will do this, why you think that this person will have an heart attack or more prone to heart attack. So all this temporal information and told to the doctor or the health specialist so that he understands why it's happening. So when you want to put this together, you have the engineering part, you have the understanding of biology part to it. So a whole lot of things goes into the explainable part. So it takes that much more domain knowledge, that much more engineers to actually create it. So it's kind of an expensive affair. It adds on to the other computation, what it requires. At intermediate, you'll have to collect intermediate data points and throw it to the users. So, and if you look at the different algorithms, what are available in artificial intelligence, they will fall into these quadrants. You have interpretability and accuracy. So you really want to move to the right this thing. You've got to use the right quadrant for the right kind of job. So if you look at random forests, well, those kind of traditional methods have got a lot of interpretability and also accuracy. But then it's very difficult to create that at times. So you may have to go in for deep learning. When you create deep learning models, the interpretability comes down. So you may have to go in for both of them in an Ansible method, mix it up so that you have some amount of explainability and some amount of ease of creating the models as well. So that's the kind of thing. And if you're actually on the leftmost bottom quadrant, then it's really unscientific. You have to move away from there. So that's how systems work. And as a user, you have to find out what kind of errors are there in the AI system. You have to be, how can I trust this? How can I explain this? So basically transparency, getting the data points, intermediate data points is transparency. Trying to understand how the cause and effect happens is understandability. And how will this actually affect? If there is a, you can tweak a cause and effect, a factor in between, and then you can drop certain information if the computational power comes down and if the time required is less without actually affecting the impact. So all of these three, XAI, stays in between and finds a sweet spot. So implementation, creating all this, this thing, philosophy and concept into algorithms, into mathematical algorithms, creating an explainable model and creating an interface for the explainable model where the human mind, a human consumer can consume. So if it's a housewife, how will the housewife, how do I throw that same information to a housewife? Or if there is a professional, how do I throw the same information to the professional? So depending upon whether the doctor is looking at it or a nurse looking at it, or you know the insurance guys or the managers, you will have different explanations for them, for their decision. And then there is an entire life cycle of how do you create this and implement it and deploy that. So basically it's all, you can use cloud in a beautiful way where you have all the data models there, predictive models. Also, you have the explainable models and their applications, which actually creates user interface and HMIs. So the other way of user interface is sometimes a working model can only you can only understand when it's working. So you can have motion, you can have AR VR modules which can actually be used, and these are all being used in engineering, bioengineering, and they need to be explainable. So right now you're generating a lot of information. You have wearable devices, you have implanted devices, you have devices which can control your mind and understand from your mind what's happening. So you really have to look after security. Therefore, DevSecOps is very important. So during the development stage, you also take in the operational guys' feedback and also the security guys' feedback. So you will actually evolve a system which has got security already embedded into the system from the formative inception stage. And so security is a very important issue, whether it's you need to actually find out your own vulnerabilities, you need to find out your gaps, and then you have to find out what kind of attacks which are taking place. So it's not just your immunity which matters, it also depends upon how strong the virus is outside, how it is growing, and what's happening. So you need to have both these factors to actually predict and strengthen. The same thing happens with cybersecurity. When you work with healthcare, no matter what data you use, you have huge compliances issues like HIPAA and GDPR and things like that you have to be aware of. You can't just simply use patients' information. You'll have to actually put certain compliances and rules and regulations in place. So you really have to understand this part of it very clearly, how your system can be hacked and how vulnerability and compromises can trump your growth, because you're working with the healthcare data and what kind of data you can really store, what you need to encrypt, in what fashion, what are the privacy laws of the client and the users and the law of the land. So you need security orchestration, automation, and response. Again, here you require explainable AI, which tells you why you need to shut off a particular server, why you need to do a certain, why that certain response is taking place. So you need to understand. Let's say if suddenly a robotic machine switches off, right? And you're doing an operation. So it could be that somebody is hacked into it, and now that robot could be taken over by a malicious actor. And that's why it's switching off. So the system should be able to tell you. As a doctor, you'll find the system going bad and you'll say, this is wrong. This is catastrophic. But then letting it be on could be more catastrophic. So all these games will be played in the machines, and the machines will have to tell you that these are the reasons why it is doing something. So in the army, actually, I was involved in a lot of these things. So we worked with a number of robots just across all this. So clinical, the thing, remote presence robots, this was placed in an ICU in Mau, where the specialists were, now that specialists were there in Jabalpur and in Delhi. And so they could be there, and there's also video conferencing. So you can move around when there's nobody. You can move from patient to patient from their bed. You can also go to the managers and your chief medical doctors and stuff like that. These are some of the dashboards, IoT integrations. So all this is basically used in different domains, but essentially the underlying technologies are same. So in healthcare, you can have a complete platform. You can have an e-commerce platform, or you can have platforms where you have managers, different stakeholders like managers, insurance companies and consultants and doctors, patients, all coming together and using data, and also different companies which normally don't share data, but here we can anonymize data and help them share, so they can share their resources. If somebody's having a particular medicine more than the other guys, so they can share it, or some beds and stuff like that, or oxygen cylinders or whatever. So it brings in a lot of optimization into the system. Right now, what happens, somebody's got some excess in this thing, resource, somebody doesn't have anything at all. So those kind of things, the issues are there. And you can also create chatbots for healthcare. So this is something which we are doing. Blockchain to actually look at the transactions. So it's distributed ledger systems. your HR analytics, how do you find out which doctor is the best doctor and what is the reason that he's best? So tomorrow you are consulting with a doctor, you have to know how is he being graded? Is it fake news and people, friends trying to help him that he's the best doctor by just giving him those 5 stars in online this thing, or is it real? So all that, and how do you actually align the right kind of doctor with the right kind of patient? So these things can be done using AI systems, and the AI system can explain also why it's recommending a particular doctor for you online. Right now, I'm looking after AI in cyber labs. We set up HPCs, high performance computers, and which can work with machine learning and so on and so forth. And we also mentor students and projects. This is some of the online courses which I'm creating for Grant Thornton. And we work with seminars, workshops, and so on and so forth. So ultimately, it's all about integrating how you integrate AI in an explainable fashion, which can help you. And this is my contact number. If anyone wants to work with me or wants to create some projects, so we are always open to that. And probably we'll also be taking on internships from your college. Right now, I presume that we'll be getting into an MOU for that. But nevertheless, this is my contact number. You can always contact me if you have any proposals. It would be helpful. With that, I've come to the end. If there are any questions, I'll just spend 5 minutes for questions. Thereafter, I have another session at 3:30, which is an important meeting with Delhi. Yeah,
yes, we have a couple of questions. The first question is, can human emotions be totally implemented in AI?
Yeah, so there is this thing, if you look at Turing machine or, his postulates, and you have Gödel's theorem, which tells you that there is always, you cannot capture reality absolutely because it's got huge amount of data there, but you can always improve. And machines are better than humans right now to capture anything. So the sentiment analysis happens by cameras. So you can detect lie, you can detect how a person feels about a particular medical program or any program. You can find out whether he's a terrorist. So all this is being used currently by surveillance systems, even in China and Singapore, this thing, airport is full of this. You don't have to carry anything. I mean, you just walk in and they just understand if this guy is a real guy or not, right? So from your eyes, so all the sentiments can be picked up, and these are great indicators, which you and me cannot really make out. So I think, yes, machines can pick up sentiments much more than what we can do, whether it is image, voice recognition, how you speak, and what's happening in your body. Your wearable device can throw out information that you are telling a lie, or how do you feel comfortable or not.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. The next one is, how AI can be misused in medical technology?
Yeah, so again, as I said, AI is a double-edged sword, right? I mean, it's just intelligence. So if you are a thief, you can become an intelligent thief and you can use AI. If you want to kill somebody, you can use AI again to kill. So it is basically trying to reduce the process. I mean, the time and space complexity in anything. But what is essential, I mean, it's really not intelligent for any species to be malicious and do this create problems, because later on, as such, for the community is bad. So the intelligence, as things get integrated, now systems get integrated faster than human beings. You may not like a Pakistani and he may not like you, but when we start using Google, Google actually controls Pakistanis and NSE, and it can actually reduce the conflicts and stuff like that. So as the AI thing, AI will become more and more ethical because of the malicious, whereas human beings, we are driven by emotions, the middle part of the brain, so therefore we will have those responses. Even if you know that you should not feel bad when your friend has said something or something, but definitely those emotions will come into play, and then you have those prejudices. And that's what politicians are actually exploiting right now, right? So we are I mean, AI can unite the world better than what human beings can do. Yeah,
thank you, sir. We'll conclude the session with vote of thanks. On behalf of JSPM's Rajarshi Shahu College of Engineering, I, Pranav Chipalkatti, heartily thank Anand Kumar, sir, for sparing his valuable time and sharing his knowledge and experience with us. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Yeah. So I'll be hopping off from here. Thank
yes,
you.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Any instructions for the
announcement?
Yeah.